Welcome to the 2 minute warning interview series, where we take a rapid, if insightful, dive into the energy transition and what it means for the Middle East and beyond. Very happy to have Jeremy Crane, CEO of Yellow Door Energy, with us today. Hi, Jeremy.
Good morning, Michelle. It's a pleasure to be with you.
Let's kick off with finance in this very broad conversation of solar power generation. It is solar power generation has rapidly ramped up in the Middle East recently, many record-breaking projects in terms of price and size. It's very much stood ahead of the rest. But the demand for decarbonisation targets and the growing political momentum behind that is also rapidly growing. In order to keep pace, do you think the Middle East is currently moving fast enough? And if not, what steps do you think need to be made?
That's a great question. So I think we've seen a lot of really exciting announcements about mega solar projects. Some of the biggest projects in the world are being built here in our backyard, and that's fantastic. But I think one of the barriers that the region faces right now is access to financing for what we call commercial scale, projects that are servicing the businesses directly on their rooftops. It's an area of financing that's advanced, much more advanced in markets like the US or Europe, where banks are more active in that space. Here, just like all other aspects of SME lending, solar for commercial scale is being limited by that access to financing.
And what are the next steps in that? Because of course, policy and finance are quite tightly interlinked as well. And the UAE's evolution when it comes to policy has been quite impressive. I mean, independence was only just 50 years ago. And in the advancement in many areas in that time has been rapid, including in solar and the broader renewable energy market. The UAE is home to its first nuclear power station now as well, which is unusual in the region, and the first carbon capture and storage project as well for steel production is in Abu Dhabi. So these are all pioneering steps that have needed policy support. So as we talk about the need for this maturation of finance really and the financial architecture, what steps can be made on the policy front to help spur that and give investors confidence?
Great question. So yeah, policy, especially in Dubai, has been very proactive in terms of encouraging distributed or commercial scale solar. And so kudos to Dubai for that. I think probably it's about scale. You know, financing works well with scale. And so for commercial scale projects, you need a lot of them. And so if the other Emirates can also enact policies similar to Dubai with net metering, or if we see it progress in the other GCC countries, I believe the financing will catch up, it'll get there. And so it's really just a matter of the rest of the region following the policies that we've seen be so successful in Dubai. And I'll reference Jordan here as another place that's also been very, very encouraging on the policy front.
In the Arab Gulf, many other nations have been making big steps, Saudi Arabia, Oman, just to tag a couple there. And they've made it very clear within their national visions and their national strategies that green growth is a huge priority. How can they turn that rhetoric into action like the UAE has? What are the top 2-3 lessons that they can learn from Dubai and the wider UAE when it comes to policy? Is it more international partnerships? Is it more policies to foster talent? Is it more on the tech side and then creating clusters for R&D? What would you suggest?
Well, honestly, today we know that solar is the cheapest form of power when the sun shines. So on a policy front, simply removing the barriers or the subsidies, the barriers to renewables in terms of how they can interconnect to the grid, and the subsidies for traditional forms of power, be it subsidized electricity rates from the utilities or diesel. If those are set at market rates, international market rates, businesses are going to transition. Businesses are agile. Businesses can switch to renewables, and they just need the right framework to do so. So I think that The Saudis in a great position, for instance, to see a large shift to renewables with the very small actions that will really, you know, there aren't subsidies need for renewables. We just need to remove the subsidies on traditional forms of energy.
On the traditional forms of energy, the subsidy removals have been ticking along since around 2016, and they've been slowly gaining pace in the region, especially with the Arab Gulf area. It has been slow, it's been stop-start, but considering the political and social environment, it's been considered huge steps forward and potential game changers. Do you think now with COVID-19 and the economic recovery, and of course every country is affected differently, but the economic recovery from COVID-19 and of course lower oil prices have been sustained for quite a while now, plus the cost of the transition for the broader energy basket, do you think all those pressure points make it an easier job to now cut subsidies, or do you think in terms of a social political argument it makes it harder?
Look, I think there's a framing that can be done right now that could be very positive for pushing the transition, right? So if we think about the policy around job creation, about local empowerment, employment, those things are more important today than ever. The need for businesses to reduce their costs is more important today than ever. Mm-hmm. So I think those two trends within the larger COVID threat, are things that will encourage governments to make those policy changes.
So we might see, or we are certainly within a window of opportunity then to see more subsidy reductions in the near term, which will help, as we're saying, propel this solar power generation capacity and scale it up.
Absolutely, absolutely. I'm very optimistic that the COVID is going to have a positive, is having a positive shift towards renewables.
Absolutely, it certainly is. And if that extends onto subsidies as well, then that is going to start accelerating a conversation that has been running for decades and has only really started picking up in the last 4 or 5 years as well. So that could be, again, another game changer for us to watch out for in the coming year. Talking about subsidies and the broader need to give financiers confidence is how we link onto clean technologies and what's happening in that space. The array of technologies emerging, and some of which have been discussed for years and years and years, but now are becoming a lot more serious and taken more seriously when it comes to R&D and commercialization, from batteries to hydrogen to digitalization and so on. And of course, there's the big broad push as the fourth industrial revolution that we're very much within. But this is also coming amidst concern about the fact that there's a lot of innovation and ideas are rife, but getting that to commercialization, and as you've already touched upon, scaling it up is a completely different story. The IEA said around 35% of cumulative CO2 emissions seen in the sustainable development scenario by 2070 compared with today, with the current trajectory, are still in demonstration or prototype phase. So the ideas are there to make decarbonisation by 2050, including, of course, solar power generation, how that fits in, are there, but getting them commercialised is not quite so. How would that develop from an investor's point of view? And also, if you had to pick two or three technologies that you think should be the focus in this huge array of opportunity, which would you choose?
That's a good question, and a very broad broad opportunity to choose technologies.
But it's a huge world.
Absolutely. My view is that storage is the key to unlocking much broader renewable penetration, and so when I look at storage, there's a broad array of technologies there. Obviously, there's batteries, lithium ion being very popular. There's hydrogen, something that we're seeing a lot of talk about these days. And then there's thermal storage, concentrating solar power, and such. I think that what we are forecasting internally in the next couple of years is batteries, lithium-based batteries, becoming economical for many of our projects. And I say the next few years, I mean, literally 2022, right?
Wow.
It's becoming to the, it's at the point now where our use cases for batteries on the near horizon, the planning horizon are there, they're possible. So we're very excited about that. What the impact of that for our customers is that maybe today we can service a customer with 20% of their power with solar. When we include batteries in the mix, that suddenly, that can shift up to 50, 60, even 80% of their power on a 24/7 basis can come from solar. And so that is gonna be the shift that I believe is needed to really get us into a cleaner generation world. If I take that one step farther, obviously electricity generation that we focus on is important. It's also going to become more important in the coming years because as people want to move away from burning fuels in their vehicles and in the transportation infrastructure, electricity is going to become more possible. And obviously lithium ion batteries are proliferating. All of the major automotive manufacturers have strong drives to change their lineup of vehicles. And so the demand for electricity is going to grow. And so those two are, I think, really exciting trends, shifting to electricity first and shifting that electricity to clean second are very, very positive trends for our industry.
And leaping back on the batteries, it's not just the customers, of course, that are going to have a huge change in the coming years with the success of the batteries that you're talking about, but also your company and other companies like yours that are perhaps able to adopt and adapt that technology. And again, the impact that that will have on investors. How much of a game changer do you feel that technology is going to be, the battery technology is going to be for you in the next 2 to 3 years? And in terms of scalability for you as a company as well?
Right, so the interesting thing about batteries is the investment or the inclusion of batteries in our projects is not a significant change in investment, right? They might add 20% to the amount we invest, but it allows us to build a bigger system. And I'm specifically looking at our customers that have weak or no grid access. That transition from that, we're able to transition them from, as I said, 20% to 80%. That means a lot more solar panels, a lot bigger generation from clean energy. And so for us, it is a major scaling opportunity. Because it unlocks potential to put in more solar.
Absolutely, and perhaps not just in the local vicinity, but far broader. As we know, 1 billion people still lack access to energy, and by many estimates, that's far below what the true figure is when it comes to real grid connectivity worldwide. Jeremy, thank you so much for joining us. Really appreciate it, and we look forward to seeing you soon.
All right, thank you very much, Michelle. It's a pleasure being here.